The topic of this lesson is Bézier curves and surfaces, which are a mathematical model to represent curves and curved surfaces. In this course, we focus mostly on linear geometries like polygons and polyhedra, which in geographic information are used in the vast majority of datasets, software, and applications. Still, curves and curved surfaces are important and very useful for a number of reasons. We can represent reality more accurately while using fewer primitives. We can avoid discretizing everything into small segments, which is notoriously prone to errors and hard to do consistently. And for a more pragmatic reason, curves and curved surfaces are widely used in CAD and BIM software anyway. So knowing how they work is useful because they're often used to produce GIS datasets. There are several ways to model curves and curved surfaces. For instance, within the course, we have already discussed how some curved solid objects like spheres, cylinders, and cones are used as primitives in CSG based on their point set definitions. We will also be looking briefly at sweep curves and surfaces when we discuss IFC later in the course. However, the two most flexible approaches are Bézier curves and surfaces, as well as Bézier splines. We will be looking at the former in this lesson. A Bézier curve is a parametric curve that is modeled based on a sequence of points. If you've ever used a vector-based graphics editor, you've likely used Bézier curves, or they're often called paths. A Bézier curve starts from the first point and ends at the last point, which are called data points. As for the intermediate points, which are called control points, the curve doesn't necessarily have to touch them, but they do have an effect by pulling the curve towards them. Also, note how the ends of a Bézier curve are tangent to the lines between the endpoints and their neighbors. Bézier curves have a degree, which is determined by the number of points in them. With 3 points, you have a quadratic Bézier curve, just like you can form a quadratic polynomial passing through 3 points. And with 4 points, you have a cubic Bézier curve. In theory, any number of control points can be used, but it is generally better to stick to Bézier curves of a relatively low degree, and the most common ones found in practice are cubics. Now, let's explain how Bézier curves are actually calculated. If we look at the top equation, we see that the Bézier curve C is a parametric curve with a parameter t that goes from 0 to 1. The equation shows how the curve is a sort of weighted average of its n plus 1 points, where bi is the weight at t, and pi is the ith point. In the second equation, we see how the weights are actually computed. B is the so-called Bernstein polynomial of degree n, which for the ith point is defined as the binomial coefficient of n choose I times t to the I times 1 minus t to the n minus I. You might be familiar with binomial coefficients if you've ever done statistics, since they are related to numbers of choices in combinatorics. Now, looking at the third equation, we see how formally n choose I can be computed as n factorial divided by I factorial times n minus I factorial. However, in practice it is easier to just take the correct row of Pascal's triangle based on the number of points we have in the curve. Pascal's triangle is created by starting with a 1, then at every step creating a new row with one extra number, so that each number fits below two numbers above, and its value is the sum of the two numbers above it. Let's see how the weights computed using Bernstein's polynomials change with t. This example is for a cubic Bézier curve, and so we have 4 weights for the 4 points in the curve. As you can expect, the weight of the first point is 1 when we are exactly at the beginning of the curve, which is t equals 0, after which it continuously decreases until it reaches 0 at the end of the curve, which is t equals 1. The weights of the two control points start at 0, slowly increase until they reach a maximum at t equals 1/3 and t equals 2/3, and then slowly decrease until they reach 0 at t equals 1. Finally, the weight of the final point starts at 0, and then increases to reach 1 at the end of the curve. Based on what we have discussed so far, it is easy to define composite Bézier curves, which are created by simply joining together individual Bézier curves, which are called Bézier segments. if we want the result to look smooth, we need to take care of G1 continuity, which is explained in the handout. For this, the only thing that's needed is to make sure that every joint point and the two points around it are all collinear. Now, let's move on to 3D and discuss two types of Bézier surfaces, rectangles and triangles. In a Bézier rectangle, points are defined based on a grid, which in this example is 4x4 because this is a so-called bicubic Bézier rectangle. The weights for each point on the grid are computed very similar to how they are computed for points on a curve, but simply using two weights rather than one. The end result looks something like this. As for Bézier triangles, things are a little different because the most convenient way to define them is based on three barycentric coordinates, which are here denoted as U, V, and W. These start at zero on each edge, and reach one at the opposite vertex. Any point on the triangle thus has U, V, and W coordinates, but it is important to note that these are not all linearly independent, because we enforce a condition that their sum is equal to 1. As you can expect, the points used in a Bézier triangle have a triangular configuration, and the surface of the triangle is computed in a similar manner than before, but now we have to use so-called bivariate Bernstein polynomials. These are a little different, and so we cannot rely on Pascal's triangle. As an example, the weight for a cubic Bézier triangle would look something like this. And the Bézier triangle itself could look like this.